You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth! I have neither the time nor the inclination to explain myself to a man who rises and sleeps under the blanket of the very freedom that I provide, and then questions the manner in which I provide it. I would rather you just said thank you and went on your way.
If imaginary numbers are at the heart of quantum mechanics, then presumably they are an inherent part of the universe. Or are they merely a mathematical construct? In other words, were imaginary numbers discovered or invented?
Oh, well, that's the key question, one of the key questions in the philosophy of mathematics. Mathematicians don't like to admit it, but if you look back at the history of mathematics, a lot of important mathematics was developed because it seemed to be a pattern or a game that nature or God also plays, not just a game that one mathematician invented one Sunday afternoon when he had nothing to do.
Thank you. I work with computers, math.
Math? What kind of math?
Number theory. Research, what? Mostly.
No way, I work with numbers myself. I mean, not traditional. I work with the Torah. Amazing! Yo, Hebrew's all math. It's all numbers. You know that? Yeah, look. The ancient Jews used Hebrew as their numerical system, eh? Each letter's a number. Like the Hebrew A, Aleph, it's one. B, Bet, it's two. You understand? But look at this. The numbers are interrelated. Like, take the Hebrew word for father. Av, Aleph, Bet. One, two, equals three. All right? Hebrew word for mother, aim, aleph, mem, 1, 40, equals 41. Sum of 3 and 41, 44. All right? Now, Hebrew word for child, all right? Mother, father, child, yelad. That's 10, 30, and 4, 44. Torah is just a long string of numbers. Some say that it's a code sent to us from God.
That's kind of interesting.
It started with the Italians and what's called polyphonic music, when they learned how to play two or more notes simultaneously.
When was that?
That started in about the 1500s.
1500?
Yeah, the Italians were the ones that did most of this. With an Italian priest named Antonio Vivaldi.
Vivaldi?
Yeah, was the one that really pushed all before. But all of the Italian musicians, particularly Frescobaldi and Gabrielli are two of them that developed the initial polyphonic music. And then Bach became the master of it. And then Handel was the great popularizer of it. So you have Handel, Bach, Vivaldi, Gabrielli, and what was the other one? Gabrielli and Frescobaldi.
Martin Luther? No.
Martin Luther was the beginning. He wrote the initial pieces of music.
With the organ of the church.
Well, the initial, that was still the Pythagorean modal music.
So all this comes from Pythagoras?
Yeah, it all comes from Pythagoras.
The modal music, you call it.
The only pieces of it remain. It's called major and minor.
Major and minor?
Yeah, well, those are all part of what are called church modes.
Church modes.
Yeah, those are extensions from the original Pythagorean system, and they had the distortion factors. Bach finally distorted the whole thing and erased it and made it a pure logarithm. So music, from that point on, always sounded harsh. But that's the only way he could play in all keys. Otherwise, you had to retune the organ for every key you played. See, it didn't matter with the voice because you could move the frequency everywhere. You're a stringed instrument, but the organ's first digital device, it's analog computer, but it's a digital keyboard, so now you're stuck to discrete frequencies, so every key you have to retune the organ. The pipe organ's one of the oldest, and with all the stops and the pipes, it's an analog computer of incredible complexity. It's a waveform synthesizer. They can't make them anymore. And the old ones are all of the metal fatigue and everything. They're all rotten. It's all gone now.
They can't make them anymore?
They don't know how to make any of that stuff.
Are you serious?
It's too complicated. They couldn't do it. None of that can be duplicated. That was made by masters. They just did it all in their head. The guy that made organs with 15, 20,000 pipes, you know how he measured the spectrum? He went into the church and took a stick and threw it on the ground and listened to the echoes, let that cook in his head, and built a 15,000 pipe organ out of it that resonated with the church. And there was no insurance back then. If you fucked up, your head got fed to the fish.
No pressure.
It just simply worked. It wasn't even a question whether it was going to work, because if it didn't, you died.
So these masters that made the organ, that was it.
Silbermann made most of the great organs in Germany.
So who?
Silbermann. Yeah. And then I don't know who made it. France had their own brand. France made some incredible sounding organs, but they sounded different than the German organs. And so, then the English, you know, had their organs and all that, and all of them are resonant, they're analog computers. You build waveforms by adding harmonics. You can make any kind of waveform you want. And the physical feeling of being in the churches when these things are running in full power is beyond description.
Really?
Particularly when all the planets are lined up.
Wow.
Scares the organists. The whole church sounds like it's going to come apart. The organists start to lose control. The whole thing gets wrapped up into the cosmic event.
This is the ultimate rave party.
And just goes wild. And it leaves the audience in complete shock. Thousands of people just like stunned in shock. They had a grand organ concert at Grace Cathedral in San Francisco right during the planetary alignment. That church was smart. They played that whole solar cycle and they did a series of 12 organ concerts. Half of the music was Bach. And it got nearer and nearer the planetary alignment. The performances started becoming more and more stunning, and larger quantities of people started showing up. So finally, the last one, there's only one seat to sit in the whole church, where all the phases line up. We'd always get those seats beforehand, hours beforehand, and make sure they were reserved.
Your family?
No, me and David.
Oh, here?
Yeah, in San Francisco, David Franklin.
So they had an organ.
We were doing that whole Sonoma State study, and the organ concert series was in that exact sync with the solar flares. And you had, of course, you were there at every one of those concerts, and they just lit that church up. We spent days preparing for these events, hiking around in the woods and just like living on fruits and vegetables. You had to take at least a 10-mile hike before the organ concert,
what?
And then get there at the top of that mountain, and then there's a couple other things you do, and you have your seats are all arranged right where all four organs, pipe organs, cross. In the cross of the church itself, they're all built like giant crosses, and they have four organs in them. They have the forward and reflected organs, the giant ones in front and back, and then they got the side organs, and there's two seats on either side of the aisle in the middle, and you get those seats, all the waves add up in that spot, and it produces, you go out of your body. You just go out, during the concert, you just go out of your body. You're not even in normal world anymore. The whole thing just completely overwhelms you. And you could actually see the music and the whole, but just in that one spot. So the grand concert, the church was too crowded, so they had to put everybody out in the main thing. But the organ concert built up so much power that the whole church went, right after the concert ended, the whole church went silent. There wasn't any applause. And the organists were like frozen, staring, like with weird looks on their face at their keyboards. It's the whole place just like went dead. It was quiet. No one was clapping or anything. And then all of a sudden, all 1,000 people jumped up for a simultaneous standing ovation like the church had never seen. It just blew everybody away.
How long was that standing ovation?
It was, the concert went on for about 2 hours.
Wow.
And it built with, you know, like one of Bach's most famous organ works, the horror movie one.
God
in D minor. Yeah, he wrote that when he was 18 years old, but I don't like that. It's juvenile and it's too dark and whatever. But these guys and the church and the alignment and the whole thing gave it a rendition of that piece of music that just wiped everybody out, including them. They lost control, the whole resonance. The building literally felt like it was going to fly apart. There was no concept of space or time anymore. You got wrapped up into this Bach cosmic cycle, and it just kept working you phase after phase, and deeper and faster and the voltage higher and higher, and it just wiped everybody out, wiped the whole audience and the organists out. And it was stunning because when you walked in, all the planets and the moon and the sun and everything were all lined up. And this thing started at sunset.
So 1980.
1980. October 13th, 1980.
October 13th, 1980.
Yeah.
And it was on top of a hill.
In San Francisco. Grace Cathedral is a duplicated cathedral. It has a 7,200 pipe organ driven by like a 25 horsepower blower.
Wow. So those organs, you can put each one in place.
You add all the harmonics in space and time, and you can make pressure, you can make entities in that church. The church is built like an Alexanderson antenna. The columns are all loaded. And you have standing wave organs pointed at each other. So you can maneuver these harmonics around in the space and position them. And they have like littler harmonics. They're like ball bearings, like those pictures of atoms. And you build these things in the space. And if you're sitting in one of those zones, you know, if you put an altimeter in there, like my altimeter, the thing will go wild. The pointer will just start dancing around. There's intense, like, low pressure and high pressure centers, and they coalesce like a giant molecular structure in the church. Wow. And the master organist and the organ builder knows how to control all those things, so the organ is part of the church, and the whole thing turns into a giant analog waveform generator. And then the music of Bach is designed to magnify that. On top of it, creates a backwards time cycle. The music actually starts and ends at both ends. That's the problem with it. No one knows how he did it.
Bach.
Yeah, there is no end or beginning. The end is the beginning. The beginning is like Steinmetz's equations. They go backwards and forwards in time and make things happen in between.
So Bach,
could use these alternating current cycles to work this stuff and just build these energies.
So Bach was AC.
Well, it's time. It's all time-based. He knew how to make music go backwards in time and forwards in time and fit together. He wrote a 20-piece organ piece just before he died. That's the one that I studied at Bilitis because I had the Marconi building as my own cathedral. This all happened during the alignment. And I had a giant stereo, and I studied that music for hours and days. It took months of listening to it to finally get the picture. It was enough to knock you out of your chair, particularly in that building. Philo would come out there, and he would just stand there, frozen with tears in his eyes, and just completely frozen by the sounds.
Oh, that,
yeah, yeah, in the space. And we used to bring him out there to heal him with it, because he was all screwed up on drugs and booze and psychosis and the whole thing. So we bring him out there and fire the whole, you know, sound system up in the Marconi building, get him all high on vegetable juice and the whole thing, and it would just go through his body, and just all of a sudden, you know, he would just freeze. It would be rejuvenated.
It worked.
Yeah, I used to deliberately sit between the speakers. And friends of mine that had back problems, I convinced them to sit between the speakers and let the stuff pass through your body, and it regenerates your body. You have to sit in between the speakers. Just like being in between all those organs in the church.
Like a multi-wave oscillator.
Well, it's a mechanical thing. It's kind of like ultrasonics.
Mechanical, just the air pressure.
Yeah, the vibration.
So the vibrations of the air hitting.
Well, and your body. When the sound waves go through your body, they move your body. And you're in a standing wave zone in between speakers. Just like you're standing in between the organs of the church. And there's these zones. And they move around. They make things fly off the bench.
Anti-gravitic.
Well, it creates a vortex, and it throws things from the surface. The waves and the bench move around. They throw things into the surface.
So you're sitting in there in that church, and you feel a current in the room?
You feel this stuff moving through your body like you're invisible.
Like the ether. It's actually moving.
Solid stuff. You could actually, when your mind is trained and you're tuned into the whole thing, most people wouldn't even get this.
Yeah, you're an extreme sensitive.
Yeah, we prepared days for this stuff. Days, sometimes like weeks, to get ready to be at that level for the full voltage.
Wow. Wow.
And then they're at the spot, you know, and you just close your eyes and go into another universe.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow,
You're just like gone. And you're so high from it afterwards, you walk the full 30 miles back to Belitis and end up there the next morning. Because it's a planetary alignment, total planetary alignment or whatever, there's always a full moon.
It make you stronger, that experience? Like physically, you feel just rejuvenated, healed, strengthened, what?
I don't know. I mean, it's just fun, you know?
I have
no idea. Of course you feel good. That's why you walk all 30 miles back to Belitis.
Here is a picture of the sundial, which you can see is labeled here. And I will get back to the significance of these figure eights that you see depicted. In the research done on many megalithic sites, the alignment of structures seems to be of great importance to the builders. The Great Pyramid, specifically, each of its sides faces and is aligned with the cardinal points, north, south, east, and west, with an error from true north of only 1/12 of a degree. The work of many researchers, including Robert Bouval, have shown that many ancient structures were also aligned with constellations, including the three pyramids of Giza at the Giza complex, which were aligned with the three belt stars in the constellation Orion. In regard to Ed, he went to a great deal of trouble to align the Polaris telescope so perfectly that a person standing from the north wall, peering through the eyepiece, would see the star Polaris. This amazing engineering feat done by a man with a fourth grade education led him to creating what is now called the sundial. The sundial seems to show figure eights that line the interior of this concave artifact. Ed had told visitors that he used it to tell time, remarking that only the hours between 9 a.m. and 4 p.m. were important because those were the hours that a man should work, and he was not interested in any other hours. The hours were marked over the figure eights, each representing, purportedly, an hour of the day. Through my research, I have discovered that the figure eights that are shown are actually not figure eights at all, but actually represent an astronomical representation of the path that the sun takes through the sky. It is called an analemma. An analemma can be found on virtually any globe of the world. Essentially, the sun follows this path through the sky throughout the year, depending upon your location on the Earth. It is also dependent upon the 23.5 degree tilt of the Earth's axis and the elliptical orbit that the Earth follows around the Sun. Ed Leeds Scanlon stated in his book Magnetic Current that astronomers did not know what really caused the seasons. He also claimed that science was wrong in regard to gravity and electricity, and that what he had discovered using his Polaris telescope, as represented on his sundial, would help scientists redefine science and also understand the true path that the Earth follows in its orbit around the Sun. It is my opinion that Ed was not stating that the Earth follows a figure eight pattern around the Sun, as represented by the analemma, but that the path as represented by the analemma reveals that at certain times of the year, based upon our orbit around the Sun and our alignment with the Moon and other planets in the solar system, creates windows of opportunity by which the power that he used to do the miraculous was easier to access and utilize.